pa.
Good evening, good evening.
How you doing?
Juan.
Hi, my brother.
We have been trying to catch up with you for a while.
Yeah, I know, but I've been working, you know.
Yeah.
We are living bad times.
working, busy.
But, yes.
Everything fell in place early this morning.
This is very important.
Yeah, and we just decided that we needed to have you and have this conversation while you had a brief moment.
Thank you, my friend.
This is Speak Freely with Barrington Salmon and Mimi Machado Luces. And our special, special, special guest is my brother, Mimi's brother, Juan de Marcos Gonzalez, who is, I'm just going to say a little bit and then I want you to say more. Band leader, creator, Afro-Cuban All-Stars, the brainchild, the creator of Buena Vista Social Club, fabulous musician, great man. He just started his Hollywood career.
Not that much.
In Vivo. We thank you. So tell us a little about who you are. I mean, everybody should know who you are, but tell us who you are.
Well, I'm a guy from downtown in Havana. I grew up in a very rough neighborhood. I'm not very proud of my small model land. I grew up surrounded by musicians, by great people in this community. And I was very lucky because my parents were smart people, and they guided me to the university. Otherwise, I should be, an outsider. Because I grew up with the most of my friends that left for America back in 1980. Mm-hmm. They were called Marielitos. Yeah. Many of them are already gone in America because they tried to do the same thing that they did in Cuba in America, and you cannot do it because it's a different place.
Yeah, yeah.
But my parents were very smart, and they guided me to go to university to study and to try to be somebody. I was the first guy in my family to step on a university. And I'm very proud of it as well, because the rest of the people didn't have the chance to go.
Yeah.
First me, then my brother. And we're coming from a very poor family, and they didn't have resources to send somebody to a university, even when it was absolutely free of charge in my country during my period, and still is free of charge.
Yeah.
But, you need to have somebody that really guides you to make it, in order to be a person, a good person, in order to be somebody valuable for your community, in order to be something special to help people.
Yeah,
you know.
You told me your father is the reason why you went to college.
Yeah, well, he wanted me to go to college. Because I was the first one. Mm-hmm. I told you. You know, I'm going to tell you something. My daddy was very intelligent. Mm-hmm. I have made some calculations based on our conversations, on our life together. Mm-hmm. And I believe that my daddy was above 145 IQ. Because he was really, really, really smart. Yeah. But he never had the chance to go to unschool properly.
Yeah.
He was practically, learned a little bit about mathematics and arithmetics and all this stuff with my mom. Mm-hmm. He never had the chance to go to unschool.
Yeah.
But if he was to unschool, I believe that he should be the first Black president. Really Black president, because we had a couple of Black guys in the past before 1959.
Uh-huh.
But he probably should be a president.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was very smart and very talented guy. He wanted me to go to a university to study and be somebody, because for him to be a musician wasn't to have a proper career.
Yeah,
he wanted me to make something really important from his point of view.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to university. I got my degrees. I got my PhD. I got everything. But back in 1990, the situation in my country, the economical situation in my country was very bad. Yeah. And I had to take a decision. I was performing at the time with Sierra Maestra professionally, but I was sharing my time between the university teaching and the university sciences, and then performing in the nights. Mm-hmm. And then in 1990, it was in July, I told my wife, well, if we want to survive this special period, which was the name of this time frame in my country, I have to become a full-time musician. And then I became a full-time musician, and I was lucky because it's not normal that living, to make a living out of music is not normal.
Yeah.
Of course, you can make a lot of money, but the possibility is one in a million.
Yeah. So tell us about Sierra, for those that don't know, tell us about Sierra Maestra.
Sierra Maestra was the first man performing Afro-Cuban traditional music in my country. Was the first one that really became successful. It was a band that we created back in 1976. All of us, we were rockers before. We used to play rock and roll. And I still love rock and roll, and I listen to rock and roll of my times, of course. I don't like the contemporary rock and roll. I mean, well, there are a few excellent guys, but I prefer the rock and roll of my times. King Crimson, the Rolling Stones, the Purple, Queen, you know, these bands. And I used to play rock and roll. Mm-hmm. But at a certain point of my life, I realized that I had to turn the eyes to the music of my country. And we founded Sierra Maestra back in 1976 at the university. Mm-hmm. We were studying at the university. Okay. And then the band initially was very famous in the university, environment. Mm-hmm. We won a few awards at the festival, national festivals, local festivals. And then in 1979, we became really nationwide famous. And then we were on top up to 1983, when Los Bambam came with a tune called El Baile de Buey Cansao, which was a top hit in my country in 1983. And then, we kept performing, and I was performing with the band up to 1997. 1997, it was impossible for me because I was leading three bands at the period. Uh-huh. And then they didn't want me to be sharing my time between several bands. Uh-huh. They wanted me to be only Sierra Maestra or with the other bands. Uh-huh. And they kicked me off.
They kicked you off?
Yeah. I remember that I was in London promoting the first album that we recorded for World Circuit called Dum Dum Banza, which is a tribute to Arsenio Rodriguez, one of the greatest Cuban musicians of the first half of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. And then they made an appointment with me in Denmark Street. Remember Denmark Street, this small street with a music shops and all this stuff near to Charing Cross Road station. And then they told me, well, Juan de Marcos, you are doing so many things, and I don't want you to keep in the band. So they kicked me off, and I kept with my Afro-Cuban stars and the Buena Vista Social Club and Rubén González. But it's a great band. They're still performing, but we were successful, I believe. Yeah. Because we were young guys performing traditional Cuban music, acoustic music, just a tres, acoustic guitar, bongo, and this stuff, only one trumpet. And then because we came from the rock and roll environment, we used to jump on stage like Van Halen. So we really hit.
Yeah.
We really hit the people of our generation. They're still performing. Mm-hmm. But they are all guys. They are like compay segundo, same as me.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
We I've had the good fortune of being able to sit with you and talk to you, write some stories about you, and I remember you saying that how you decided that you were going to do Buena Vista. Can you tell us about that?
Well, the Buena Vista Social Club was a project. I was in London at the period. It happened around the same time when I was kicked off Sierra Maestra. And I was promoting the album Dumbanza. And then once I met, normally I used to go to the office of World Circuit, a small label in London that produced executively the album for us.
Yeah.
And then I met Nick at the office. And then we got down to have a beer at the pub. There's a pub at the corner. This is Cleveland Street, near to Warren Street Tube Station.
Yeah, yeah.
And then in Cleveland Street, there's a pub. There's a pub at, I don't know, 30, 40 yards from the Nick's office.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then we got down and we were talking about Cuban music, about all of this stuff. And he told me that he wanted to make an album called something like a Cuban jam session, something like the kind of jams that we used to have in our country in the 50s. And then he went to Jesus Alemany, who was the trumpet player of Sierra Maestra. Jesus was living in London because he married a friend of us called Lucy Duran. And then he was living in Camden Town, there in London North. And then he told me, well, I spoke with Jesus because I wanted to make the album with Jesus, but Jesus cannot do it. Jesus signed in the period a contract with a small label as well, but a lot bigger than World Circuit, called Raiko Disc. It was a label under the banner of David Byrne. And then Jesus signed with them, and then he told me, well, Jesus cannot do it because he signed with this label. And I told him, well, I have had the idea to make an album like this for years. And if you want, I'm your guy. I'm the one that I'm going to produce the album for you. And he said, yes, this is a good idea. So we started calling this album the Big Bands album, because it should be with a big band, with arrangements and all of this stuff. But at the same time, he wanted to record one more album using the music of the eastern side of the island. You know, in the different regions of the island, we have a different style for playing the song tradicional. And then he loved, and I loved too, the music of the eastern side of the island, but the urban music of the eastern side of the island, the urban song, song urbano of the eastern side of the island, Santiago de Cuba, Guantanamo. And then, because he got in love with the music of Nico Saquito, Guillermo Portavales, Compay Segundo, Miguel Matamoros, and he wanted to make something like this. He made a compilation of Guillermo Portavales previously, and one more compilation using the music of Matamoros, I believe. I'm not completely sure. But he made a production using a live concert of Nico Saquito with the Cuarteto Patria, featuring Eliade Ochoa. Nico Saquito was an idol in my country, one of the greatest composers we have had in the history of our country. And then he wanted to make something like this and mix this kind of music with some African elements. You know, for them, for the Europeans and the white guys, world music means Africa. This is what they call world music. And he wanted to bring a couple of great Malian musicians and invite also Ray Cooder, who was... who recorded for him with the great Malian guitar player Ali Fakature, an album called Talking Timbuktu. You know, Ray Cooder is he's been working on this kind of stuff for years. And then I said, okay, we are going to record a couple of albums. I'm your guy. So I got back to Havana and I looked for the musicians to record both albums. For the big band album, we didn't have name for the albums or for the bands or whatever at the period.
Yeah.
But I got back to Havana. I looked for the musicians. I tried to find the friends of my daddy, you know, because in my country, there's a religion that, of course, you know, which is called Regla de Ocha, but it's commonly called Santeria. I don't like the name Santeria. Because this is a colonialist and a pejorative name, but it's called La Regla de Ocha or Chung Chango, you know. And then every 7th of September, we used to have parties in our house dedicated to La Virgen de Regla. And there were a lot of musicians, the friends of my daddy, coming to my house every 7th of September. So I tried to find these guys first.
Okay.
And then I looked for the most of them. Some of them were already too old to perform, but I captured some of them, Rubén González, Puntillita, Pío Leiva, who were stars in the Buena Vista Social Club.
Mm-hmm.
And then I sat down and I wrote the arrangements for the big band's album, because for the big band, you need arrangement. You have to write music, you have to give the charts to the musician, they sit down and they record.
Yeah.
That's what I did. And then we prepared a repertoire in advance for the Eastern album. So in March of 1996, we got in the studio and we recorded first the big band's album with no name at all.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote only two songs for the album, two original songs, but trying to preserve the style, the spirit of the time.
Yeah.
Because we wanted to tribute the 50s, which I believe is the golden period of the Cuban music. And then for the Eastern album, we prepared a repertoire in advance because you don't have to write music for the song oriental. So everybody knows everything about the music, and this is something that's more improvised.
Yeah.
It's something that you can rehearse and that's it. You don't have to write to a tres player or to a double bass player because the sequence of chords are simpler than if you are writing for a big band that you need counterpoint and all of this stuff. So we prepared these two albums and we went to studio in March 1996. We recorded the big band's album, and then Rai arrived. The African guys couldn't make it because we didn't have an embassy in Mali. Okay. So they sent the passports to Paris, and the passports were lost on the way.
Yeah.
So they couldn't make it. They couldn't come. And then Rai arrived a week later, and we started recording the Buena Vista Social Club. And then what was later called the Buena Vista Social Club, it was the Eastern album. Yeah. And then we took some of the songs that we already had in mind, but Compay Segundo arrived to the recording. And then he was an encyclopedic knowledge of everything. And he changed some of the songs, and you know.
Yeah.
And then at the end, we recorded I don't know, perhaps about 20 songs. At the end, we had only 12, I believe, 12, 13 songs in the original album.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the history. And then, you know, world music is not commercial music. You know, Madonna or Britney Spears or Rihanna, they have a marketing team.
Yeah.
That they don't go to send... they don't go to Twitter. They don't tweet. In fact, they have people to tweet on their behalf.
Yeah.
So they do have, in the period, there was no Twitter, I believe.
Yeah.
No, at all. Yeah. But they had, in commercial music, they do have a marketing team. But in world music, you don't have a marketing team. Even the money that Nick brought to Havana in order to pay the musicians in order to produce the albums was a loan from Lloyd's Bank in London.
Mm-hmm.
It was a loan. Yeah. That's it. So we had to create a band to present the three albums, because at the end we recorded a third one for Rubén González.
Yeah.
who was everybody fell in love with Ruben, who was absolutely outstanding. And then we created a band to present the three albums, and we got on tour on April of 1997 with the band that we called Afro-Cuban All-Stars, but presenting the music of the three albums. There was only one band. And then at the beginning, everything was normal. We were very well accepted by the audiences, but not that much, these massive concerts or whatever. But 3 months later, it was unbelievable because it was a hit. And suddenly everything became commercial. And we sold about, before the film, we had sold, I believe, about 2 million copies, which is unbelievable.
Yeah.
Because it is world music. I don't know. Gloria Estefan can sell much more in a couple of years because she is a commercial music performer. We were playing the same music that we have played for a century in our country. There's nothing new, because sometimes the people say, oh, Maestro, you have done something outstanding. And I have to say, well, listen, man, the music that we play in the Buenavistas Club is the music that we've played for a century in my country. And the music that we played with the Afro-Cuban All-Stars first album is the music that we played from 1930 to 1965. It's the same music. Yeah. There's nothing new. Yeah. In fact, it was the hand of God.
Yeah.
It was the hand of God. Because, you know, there were so many old guys, good persons, and they were completely in a bad shape.
Yeah.
Because when you get old, nobody, the people don't. You are beloved. Mm-hmm. You know, oh, the viejito, you know, pobrecito viejito. But nobody takes care of you. Yeah. You are an old guy, and they were completely disappeared. They didn't have the chance to perform. Ibrahim was retired. Cachaito was playing soup music, what we call soup music, which is entertaining in a restaurant. Everybody's eating and speaking, and he was playing the double bass, you know. And Ruben Gonzalez didn't have a piano. He used to walk about 5 miles every day in order to go to the house of an old musician, a great musician, called Senen Suarez. And he used to walk about 4 or 5 miles in order to go to the house of Senen to play the piano. And suddenly they became pop stars.
Yeah.
Compay Segundo, Rubén González, Pop, Ibrahim Ferrer.
Yeah.
I saw John Ladies behind them.
Were you surprised?
They are musicians. They were musicians. Yeah. So they were like every musician.
Yeah.
So they were spicy as well.
Yeah.
And this lady, you know, I remember one lady that wanted to marry Rubén. And when Eneida, the Rubén's wife, knew about this young lady trying to marry Rubén, she remarried Rubén because they were divorced. So she remarried Rubén. Because otherwise the money should go to another place. And she was the one taking care of him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was a nice period, you know, for I was working with them up to 2000, leading all the bands.
Yeah.
But then we had so many, you know, contracts, a lot of work. So we split the band. We split the bands, and then I kept the Afro-Cuban All-Stars in order to play both traditional and contemporary music. And we created a band for Ibrahim Ferrer, which wasn't precisely this kind of traditional lineup. It was a big band, five saxes, three trumpets, and two trombones. A big band for Ibrahim Ferrer. And they, Ibrahim brought Ruben to play the piano in certain parts of the show, and Omar Aportuondo, who wasn't at the beginning with us, except in the concerts of the Buena Vista Society Club.
Yeah, yeah.
The Carnegie Hall, Le Carré in Amsterdam, Mexico, Auditorio Nacional, these places.
That's great. That's great. That's great.
So it's 25 years since
It's 25 years since you did that?
Yeah, 25 years, man. 25 years of the day I entered there. Well, 25 years and 5 months, mm-hmm. I believe, because it was in March.
Yeah.
Marzo, abril, mayo, junio, julio, agosto, septiembre, and 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
25 years and a half.
Wow.
Of the times of the recording. But I was so happy because I was, in certain sense, a vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
To give the old guys a second chance.
Yeah, yeah.
Because if you're a musician, you are, you can be, I don't know what's the word on how to say the, you can be jubilado, I don't know what's the word in English, but you are never retired. You know, you are out of the normal job
you
used to have, but you are not retired. You keep being a musician. Yeah. And I, in certain sense, I was a vehicle to give them a second chance. And they really used this second chance. Yeah. They became really famous, very respected. Mm-hmm. People like Ibrahim Ferrer, whose name never was in an album. I'm going to tell you more.
Yeah.
When we were to present the album in England,
mm-hmm.
we had a concert at the Ronnie Scott's in Soho. In Ronnie Scott's. But then we had a problem because the Ibrahim, you have to show the home office that they are real musicians and they are not some people that you're bringing in order to do wrong things.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it was impossible to find out an album with the name of Ibrahim Ferrer.
Mm-hmm.
So I sat down in my computer and I make a cover of an album in Photoshop with the name of Ibrahim Ferrer, and I sent it to home office. Yeah, and they gave them him the visa. And after that, he was a special guest in the whole United Kingdom. After that, but we did, at the beginning, it was really hard. I had to do several things. I remember when the Carnegie Hall, no, it was after the Carnegie Hall, it was a tour that we were going to perform here in America, to play here in America.
Mm-hmm.
And there were some meetings and this stuff with Ibrahim Ferrer, who was already on star, and the Americans. At the American embassy in Cuba, they didn't want to give a visa to Kachin, who was Ibrahim's wife. And I had to go. I asked for a meeting with a cultural attaché mm-hmm. of the embassy. I spoke with him and I said, well, listen, Ibrahim Ferrer is selling millions of copies of his album. He's not a danger for America. He's a nice person. His wife is absolutely excellent. And they are not going to keep in America because they don't pay taxes in Cuba.
Yeah. Yeah.
So all the money that he's making is absolutely free of tax free.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then they gave the visa to Kachin.
Mm-hmm.
I had to do several things.
Yeah.
I had to do a lot of things. But we were happy, man.
Yeah.
We were happy and we did what we wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
They were selling out concerts until the end of their lives.
Mm-hmm.
Ibrahim, Rubén, Cachaito,
mm-hmm.
all of them, Puntillita.
Yeah.
And then the rest of us, we are still selling out concerts.
Yeah, yeah.
And I used to be the younger guy in the team, and I'm already an old guy. I'm the same age Ibrahim had when I brought him to the studio. 67 years old.
Yeah, yeah. I want to, for those who may have just joined, we are having a conversation. We're speaking freely with Juan de Marcos Gonzalez, who is a giant in the musical world, Cuban musician, band leader, creator, all these things. I mean, so many things. Now he's an actor, you know.
I'm not an actor.
Okay.
I got a role in a film, and this is a different thing. You know, I've been in several films, but normally I'm interviewed, or I play my music, or I write music, in a special piece for a film, but I never worked as an actor, and they wanted me to do it.
Tell us about how that came about and what you did.
Well, they contacted my agent here in America, and they said, well, we would like to contact Juan de Marcos because we would like to have him in a film. And I said, in a film? Well, okay. And then, well, ask them to send me some, script and some lines that I can rehearse or whatever, because they wanted to make something that I believe that you call casting, that this is a kind of test or whatever. Yeah. And then they sent me some lines, and then I rehearsed the lines with the helping hand of my daughters and my wife. Mm-hmm. And I sent them the files, the video files, and they were absolutely happy. They said, well, you're the guy. And I said, well, sabroso de verdad. And I was very happy to get the character. And then I was recording with them 2018, 2019. And then they didn't know how to end the film, you know, because I've seen that in Hollywood, they work in the same way as the rock and roll bands. You know, the rock and roll bands, they go to studio, for example, and they look for the mood, they smoke a little bit of weed, or they drink, some whiskey or whatever in order to create a song and make a good performance, you know. And I believe that in Hollywood, they work more or less the same. They have a script, they have a guy, but I recorded the same thing several times because they were changing until the end that they killed me. They killed me in the film, which was great. And I was happy working with them.
It was great that they killed you?
Because it is a good message for the kids. Because the death is a part of the life. They have to understand that their parents are going to die, and even themselves, they're going to die, because everybody has to die in order to open space for the people that's coming next. You know what I mean? And then I was happy working with them, very professional people. I recorded there in their studios in Sunny, in LA, a few times, but then in 2020, everything was bad. And then I started recording here in my studio, which is the one that you can see in the back. This is my small studio. It's not a big thing. The ceiling is not high, but it sounds good. And I have good equipment. And then I recorded the music here. I recorded the first take of the music there in LA, but then they changed the arrangement. They wrote new lyrics, and then I finished recording here in my house. And everything was okay. It's a nice film. It's a good film because it talks about, inclusion, about diversity, about love, about friendship, about death, and how a song can change the world. And this is true. But I really enjoyed working like as a voice actor for the first time in my life.
A voice actor. And I think Mimi was telling me that it's had millions of views and that type of stuff.
Beg your pardon?
That it's had like millions of views.
It's top 10.
Top 10? That the film Vivo is top 10?
Yeah. It's been top 10 for a while.
Okay.
There's something saying that Genelec are the best. I've used Genelec speakers, and I have a brand new Genelecs in there. But I like the sound of these old Genelecs. And then Vivo was a good experience. It was the first time that I was working like as a voice actor, and it was okay. The people liked it.
Yeah,
the people liked my voice with this low wind that we black guys have.
Yeah.
The low end of the black guys.
They'll be calling you again. So Mimi wanted to show the trailer. So we'll show the folks the trailer, then we'll come back at the other end.
Ah.
Are you ready, Vivo?
Presenting the one and only Vivo.
It's nice. This is one of the songs that I sung in the film.
Did you write it?
No, it was written by Lin-Manuel. Lin-Manuel wrote all music of the film.
Okay.
But I was just a performer.
Mm-hmm.
I was a performer. I didn't play my tres because they wanted to record the tres in New York City. I cannot go there.
Yeah, yeah.
In the middle of the pandemic.
Yeah.
At my age, no way. Mm-hmm. I didn't go. So I said, I spoke with Alex Lacamoire, who was the music producer of the film.
Mm-hmm.
And I gave him a couple of names of my friends in New York City. And one of them recorded the tres.
Okay.
And I just sang here in my studio.
Yeah, yeah. That's cool. Mimi, jump in. I don't know why you're hiding.
She's not on camera.
No, now she,
here she's coming up.
I don't know what she's doing.
Whatever, dude. Oh, it doesn't work. We're in the same room. Estamos en la oficina.
En la misma casa y tienen un reverb.
Tengo there, reverb.
Yeah, there was a reverb.
Y me marea.
Oh, sí, claro. I don't like the reverb. Right now, it's in fashion to use too much reverb in the music.
Oh.
Yeah, it's too much. You know, I like the music, the style of the late 90s, beginning of the 2000s. Not too much high top, not too much reverb. Just the normal reverb that you can use in order to recreate the space. But the best way to record, no reverb at all, you record live. If you record live, then you, if you have a good studio with high ceiling, then you can get the proper natural reverb. And this is the goal. This is the goal. The engineers of the past, if you listen to Billie Holiday, is everybody playing together, everybody playing at the same time in the studio, and then two mics, one for the singer and one for the band, and you can listen everything because they add the dynamics to the music. And the reverb is the natural reverb. When you listen to a remastered Billie Holiday album, it's not the same thing.
Yeah.
It doesn't sound like the original recording because they add reverb and compression and all this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
No compression, no reverb, natural sound, and the people should play properly. No auto-tune. The right thing.
Yeah, that's very true. I had my best musical moment in my life was being in the studio in Havana.
In Havana.
In Egrem, when you were recording Rostro, and I didn't have time to come into the control room, and you told me, sit down, Mimi.
Mm-hmm.
and Emilio was shooting, and I sat down almost underneath the piano, and to sit in a Egrem next to David Alfaro playing that piano in your head. It was the most
amazing
moment.
Amazing. Yeah. Because this is the real thing.
Yeah.
Everybody playing together. And everybody should play properly.
Yeah.
If everybody plays good, the recording is going to be good. And you don't need to use any kind of trick. Perhaps just tiny bit of compression in order to make it a little bit louder, and that's it.
Yeah. Oops, did we lose him? Yeah. I think we lost him. But he'll come back. Technical difficulties in the studio. I love the stories that Juan tells, and our being able to be a part of this is really amazing. So
back, can you hear me? I'm back. Yes. Communication breakdown.
Yeah. So we had a question.
We had a question.
Yeah. Ada was asking, I'm going to show the question.
Juan, you remember my girlfriend Ada, the filmmaker?
Yes.
Ada Babano. Ada's asking, don't know if this was already asked, but how did he become involved in the project? And it's not a Disney project, Ada.
No.
It's a project.
It's Sunny Pictures. Well, yeah. I got in the project because I believe that they were looking for somebody like me because of my history, you know, because the character is more or less myself. In certain sense, I have done the same things that they used to do, even busking in the street. Because I remember back in 1991, everything was bad in Cuba, and I was busking at the London subway. In order to make some money and send it to Cuba because everything was bad. So I have done everything. I have helped young people, the people of the young generation. I have helped the old guys. And I believe that precisely because of my history, they were trying to find me. And they, you know, I did my casting and I was approved by them. And they said that it was okay, that I am an actor. So I don't believe that I am, but you can do whatever you propose, whatever you want to do, if you have the spirit, the proper spirit, and you are a fighter, and I'm a warrior. I was born and...
We know that.
I was born in a very bad situation, and I have made it. I've made it.
Yeah.
I have studied a lot. I read a lot. I cannot go to the bed without reading at least, I don't know, 25, 30 pages of a book.
Yeah.
Of a book, not social media.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Reading right now.
Yeah. But right now, Isaac Asimov, one more time, because there's a series of Asimov written during the 50s called Foundation. And I loved this series of novels, three novels. And the three novels are great because I love these histories, these novels, when you have the history of a family or the history of a country, you know, like Cien Años de Soledad, 100 years of loneliness. I don't know how do you translate it.
Solitude.
Oh, yeah. Because it's a history of a family along the times. And this is something that's very good in order to be accustomed to the death. Because we are all going to die at a certain point.
Yeah, yeah.
I suppose that I'm not going to die so soon, like my character in the film. But I'm going to be here for a short while. I'm going to be for a while.
Good.
Nearby. What I don't know is when I'm going to perform again. Because with this situation of the COVID, my last concert, Mimi was there. And she helped me to set up four cameras. And I recorded the whole concert. And I have already a couple of songs that I'm going to send you. Unfortunately, it's not working really fast. I don't know if I'm going to have the time, but I'm going to send you the links. I'm going to upload to Dropbox so you can have a look to the music that I recorded. And you were there as well, Barrington.
Yeah, I enjoy
the Strathmore, January 31st, 2020. This was my last concert.
Wow.
And I've done several things online so far. And I believe that this is going to be the way until everything is a little bit clear.
Yeah.
Because we don't know what's going to happen. And the people is not some people. Mm. I respect everyone, the way of thinking of everyone. But there are so many conspiracy theories and this stuff. And
Yeah.
I believe the vaccination is a need. Yeah. It's a need. Mm-hmm. Definitely. Everybody should be vaccinated in order to see if we can get out of this nightmare. You cannot go without taking risk anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's funny because I've been reading all these, like maybe the past week, 2 weeks, mm-hmm. all these talk show hosts, Republican conspiracy theorists, they're all dying.
Yeah.
They're all dying.
They're all dying.
Yeah.
And I'm
on
like,
on the deathbed, they're saying, oh, please give me the vaccine.
Yeah.
What are you going to do now?
Well, listen, I have a friend. He's from Tampa, Florida. He's a great cigar maker. Mm-hmm. And then they are young. He's 46, I believe, 45. His wife is only 44 years old. And she's asthmatic. And besides asthma, she has diabetes.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow.
And then they didn't take the vaccine. Mm-hmm. And right now, the lady is at the hospital. She's been in the hospital for 10 days. In really bad shape, mm-hmm. in bad conditions. And this is a badness. But they follow the Mr. Doc advices. Donald Duck's advices.
Not Donald Duck.
Yeah.
It's a mistake.
Yeah.
You should vaccinate yourself up. There's nothing bad with this. I don't know what's happening.
But consider the alternative.
Yeah, you could die.
You can die.
You can die. If you have the vaccine, perhaps you can get sick, but you are not going to die. It's mm-hmm. going to be like a bad flu. Understand?
Yeah.
Or you can die, because it all depends on how you are written in the history of the old guy up there. You know, you can die.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the probability, because this is the goal, the mm-hmm. probability is a lot smaller.
Yeah. If you're vaccinated, yeah.
If you're vaccinated.
Yeah.
So everybody should take a vax.
Juan, what are you getting ready to do now? What else is coming up for you in this time? It's odd, but what do you have on the horizon?
I'm going to sit down. I'm going to write a couple of albums that I have always wanted to do. I wanted to make an album, a live album, but recording in a studio in the same way that I recorded the A Toda Cuba Le Gusta or the Buena Vista Social Club or the Distinto Diferente, everybody at the same time in a studio or in a small theater, like this one in South Orange, New Jersey. They have a great small theater for about 800 people. The river is not that long. It's very dry, but with the proper river and a high ceiling to get everybody there and then carry my equipment, because I can carry all of this stuff, go there and record them live. I want to make a couple of albums like this. One of them should be performing big band style, and the second one should be absolutely traditional in the style of Sierra Maestra, something mm-hmm. like the music that I used to play with Sierra Maestra. These are the two albums that I would like to make. I'm going to be working on it, and I suppose to get back to stage in February if everything is not bad. If everything is bad, I'm going to cancel the tour.
Okay, and in February, where will you be?
Well, New York, I'm going to play the East Coast, New York, here in the area. Perhaps it's going to be Washington, D.C. or Virginia somewhere. I'm going to play New Jersey, Philly, the East Coast. And then we're going to fly to the West to perform L.A., San Francisco, and all of these places. And perhaps we're going to have a concert in the middle, St. Louis, Missouri. Because they wanted me for a long time, and I canceled the last year. So I'm not completely sure that this tour is going to happen, but we're going to know very soon. It all depends on how develops this thing of the pandemic.
Yeah. So Ada's asking, do you have any plans to do anything with your musical daughters?
What do you mean with my daughters?
Do you have any plans to I guess, a project with them?
Oh, yeah, of course they are going to be performing with me. But I'm thinking about this album with the acoustic sound. I'm going to use a lineup similar to Compay Segundo. I'm going to use only one trumpet and one clarinet. That I love the sound of a clarinet. My daughter is so good. The glicerita is going to play a vibraphone. Perhaps I'm going to use a marimba to sound something like the music of the eastern side of the island, marimba instead of a vibraphone. So all depends on the... I have to sit down and write the music. I take a lot of time because I'm a perfectionist.
You
and
are?
Sometimes I say, well, I can be mixing one song for 15 days.
Yeah.
And then I listen to it, so no, I don't like it. I'm going to correct this and this stuff. And then I mix again, and I have sometimes 25 different mixes of the same song, trying to get the proper sound that I'm looking for. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to keep working with my daughters. They are absolutely special. They are so good. I'm very proud of my children. The older one is a great engineer. He called me yesterday, and he got a very good job. He used to work in the Navy. He used to be a Navy guy, my son. But he left the Navy, and he got a contract with the people that's working for the Navy, and they are paying three times more than in the Navy. He was a chief, but they are paying a lot more, and this is good. And with my daughters, they are fighting. They are working. Not as musicians should be, but they are fighting. Because the most important thing is to be useful and do things. It doesn't matter. Because I've done everything in my life. I have cut cane. I have I've been in the tobacco fields. This was the way we grew up in my country. Mm-hmm. So I hope that they are going to find my daughters, they are going to find a way.
Yeah,
they are.
Big band US jazz greats.
Jazz greats or people that you've wanted to play with or have played with that you want to tell us about?
Oh yeah, there's a guy, he's not a jazz great, he's more a country guy. His name is Charlie Muscle White. And there's an album of Elias Ochoa with him. And I would like to invite him to one of my albums to play the harmonica with me. I would like also to make an album or to make a recording with Coltrane's son. Because Coltrane's my idol, you know. I have been studying the pentatonic scales of Coltrane for years, and trying to put these pentatonic scales in the son montuno, you know, in the kind of music that I play. I would like to make something with him. He's a great sax player, and perhaps with Chucho Valdez.
Mm-hmm.
I have written some pieces for piano, featuring the piano in son montuno. Or in Latin jazz, and I would like to make a recording with Chucho. Chucho is already 80 years old.
Yeah.
80 years old, Chucho.
He was my second interview after I interviewed Tito Puente. He came to Wolf Trap, and I interviewed him. And then you guys came the next year. And the floodgates opened because in 2002, maybe, is when Bush allowed Cuban musicians to come to the United States. What did that do for the Afro-Cuban All-Stars?
Well, we were forbidden to come to America for a while. I remember that we played up to 2002, I believe, up to 2002. And then 2002, 2003, I believe that we were able to perform here in America. But everything stopped up to 2009 when Obama got the power. And then Obama opened the doors of America to the Cuban musicians. It was very difficult in the past. I remember that I came for the first time in 1994 with Sierra Maestra. And we played a residency in Madison, Wisconsin. And some more places, Detroit, St. Louis, and New York City. But after 1994, we played again 1997, I believe. Then 1998, the County Hall and all this stuff. And then 1999, 2000, 2001, 2002. I believe that three, I'm not completely sure. But then suddenly everything stopped because Mr. Bush put the name of Cuba in the list of terrorist countries. Yeah. Yeah, so we were unable. I believe that we are back in the same list.
You are. You are.
We are back.
Thanks to Mr. Duck.
Mr. Duck. Yeah. And then, well, we are back in the list. So for the Cuban musicians, it's very difficult. Even I knew a couple of days ago that if you were born in Cuba, but you don't live in Cuba and you have a second citizenship, you cannot use ESTA, something that's called ESTA, in order to enter the United States. You need to apply for a visa. Oh, and wow. Before, it was possible for people with a second nationality, like, for example, a European nationality, to come to America using the ESTA. Right now, it is not possible at all. So I believe that at a certain point, everything's going to be better.
Yeah.
I hope that's going to be better, that everything is bad so far. But Cuban music is, winning. Anyway, we play Europe a lot, and these young guys, unbelievable jazz players that we do have in the country, they are performing Europe a lot. Yeah. Some of them here. I love this lady. I believe that she's living in Canada, actually. Daimea Rosena. You know her?
Do you? That's our other buddy. You know, Barrington and I met her when she came through D.C. a couple of times. She's amazing. Really
amazing.
I love her voice. I really wanted her to, I would have loved for her to play Marta in Vivo.
Should be better. She or what's the name of this lady? She's an actress, and also she's a singer. I have forgotten the name of the lady. She's Cuban American, born in New York City, I believe. Uh-huh. It's a beautiful black lady with just beautiful lips. Uh-huh. I don't remember her name.
Gina Torres.
But she's not a singer.
Gina Torres.
Does she sing?
She sings.
Oh, I didn't know that. Oh, wow.
I'm very good, by the way. So I thought that it should be better to have Gina instead of Gloria. Gloria is a good singer.
Yeah, Gloria's a good singer. But it looked like the all of the artwork, it looked like the character of Marta in Vivo was Celia Cruz. And I was like, why Gloria instead of a black woman?
A black woman, yeah. But well, this is the thing, and they looked for Gloria. She's a good singer at the end. But Gina Torres, she sings very good.
Okay.
Yeah. I've heard her singing spirituals and some religious American music and soul and this stuff. She's a good singer. She's very good. And Daimee, she's very good as well. She can sing in English with my accent, with our Cuban accent, which is a different thing. Because Gloria is very American. She's an American singer.
She's American.
She's American. She came here when she was only a couple of years old.
She's American. Daimee, we saw her at Blues Alley here. And when she found out Barrington was a priest, she asked him to read her upstairs in this very small place. And it was the most interesting.
Yeah, she's very religious. She's daughter of Oshun. Oshun, I believe. Oshun, Omoyemaya, one of these orishas. And she's a great singer. She's living in Canada, is she?
I don't know.
I'm not sure. I have her like tour number. I'd love to get you two together.
Well, we were supposed to perform together in January or February, I don't remember exactly, 2020 at the Soraya, you know, there at the Northridge University Council Hall. Mm-hmm. We were supposed to play one set of her band, one set of my band, and then at the end we'll get together in order to play a couple of songs. And I already had the arrangement and everything because I wanted her to sing in Spanish, a version of Billie Holiday.
Oh, wow.
Easy living.
Oh, nice.
Living for you. It's easy living.
I love it.
No, she is absolutely outstanding. She is outstanding.
Yeah.
Cuban music is great, man. During all of these years that we were isolated, we created a lot of different genres in our country.
Mm-hmm.
Here, the music that was played during the salsa period is basically the music that we played during the 50s with, of course, new vision, new arrangements, a new way of interpreting, of performing the Afro-Cuban music of the old times, because Pacheco, Larry, all of them were musicians that went to Cuba during the 50s in order to enjoy the Cuban music, learn Cuban music, and then got back here and played the Afro-Cuban music. But in Cuba, because we were isolated, we kept creating new things. And in the 60s, we had Mozambique, we had Pilon, we had Simale, we have Papa Cuncun, we have a lot of different genres that we were creating. Then La Timba, that the timba of the 70s that I used to call the proto-timba. Prototimba or timba, traditional timba, you know, Iraquere, Opus 13, Afro-Cuba, great bands and great music. But this music is not really well known. Even timba, the contemporary timba, is not well known here in America. The people don't know what to do with La Timba because it's so strong, so punchy, so aggressive.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
They don't know.
That was my big favorite thing. I still love that acoustic sound, that Sierra Maestra, that Afro-Cuban All-Stars sound. But timba was my love when I first met you, and you took me to school in our first interview.
Yeah, and you know, timba is great. Timba is great. But, you know, what you cannot do if you are playing, for example, for the kind of audience that I play with intellectual people of mid-age and this stuff, you cannot play one timba, one more timba. You have to make a repertoire where you can show a diverse repertoire using the different styles of Cuban music. We have a lot. And then at the end, when you play La Timba, well, remember the concert. Yeah. When I play my son, my timba, everybody was dancing and jumping because it's good music.
Yeah,
it is,
and it has a message for the people. Yeah. Free yourself from the ones behind.
Well, it's
keep it alive.
It's funny because when I met her, I was playing timba,
and she was like,
"What the hell?" And I was like, "I love timba."
She has a problem with timba.
Yeah,
with the timba district.
Yeah,
in New York City, I don't remember exactly the name of the radio station.
I don't do it anymore, but I still have the Facebook page, and I like to share my my playlists. And that timba is something that will stay with me for the rest of my life. It's the first time I heard it. I went to that club in DC, Havana Village, and I heard Me Pone La Cabeza Mala. By Ban Ban. And Ban I was Ban. Like, ¿Qué es esto?
It's a train. And you are inside of a train and you are enjoying the moment. It's absolutely well, you cannot dance in a row five Te Pone La Cabeza Mala because it is too much. You need something slower and then Te Pone La Cabeza Mala. At the end, you can play 3-4 timbas. I've done it. I have done it in concert halls because normally I play concert halls in the concert halls. And everybody dancing, and they are not related to the Cuban culture or the Latin culture. They are, I don't know, normal people from, I don't know, Serbia or England or Australia. And they consume
music
the timba easy. If you know how to locate the timba in your lineup, in your setup.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
George, my dance partner Tito, he says the best music is Latin music, and that you guys are the best orchestra in the world.
Yeah, great.
It's very, very true. So
I don't think so, but it's a great band. What I know is that they are great. They are a great band. They are outstanding.
So, you know, I just want to let people know that coming up next Tuesday at 7:30, if you go to pgcc.edu/arts, you can get yourself a ticket and watch a live performance of Juan de Marcos and the Afro-Cuban All-Star.
Yeah, September 21st at 7:30 p.m. Yeah. This is the timing, and we're going to be at the Prince George's Community College. Yeah. It's on streaming, of course.
Yes.
It's on streaming, but it's going to be great. We are going to have fun.
Yeah.
And perhaps we're going to speak backstage. Are we?
Yes. we went I went into this actually, and we had a great conversation, and he shared some special things that we're not sharing here, so you have something to look forward to, and great performances. I'm very, very proud of being able to speak to you tonight. You know, my sister's birthday is tomorrow, and you know how much she loves you. So,
which one?
Debbie.
Debbie.
Yeah.
One more year.
Yes, one more year.
I'm going to send her a message. Okay. But I'm going to do it right now because otherwise I'm going to forget it. You know, the most important thing about the concert at the Prince George's Community College is that we are going to be playing 7 different styles of the Cuban music. It's everything is different, so the people can appreciate that our music is not only pachanga. You can listen to the music. We are going to play Latin jazz or Afro-Cuban jazz. We are going to play song. We are going to play danzón. We are going to play Mozambique. We are going to play mambo. So we're going to play 7 different styles of the Creole music, and I believe that the people is going to enjoy the concert.
There's a song on there that you said that Glicerita wrote, your daughter wrote.
The first one?
Okay, and it's an
Afro-Cuban jazz. It's a mix of Afro-Cuban jazz in the section intro, section A, section B. Then back to section C with mambos and all of this stuff. And then it goes to Abacua music. You know, Abacua is an Afro-Cuban religion, just for men. It's a kind of African masonry that came to our country from the people of the Calabari Coast long time ago.
Wow.
Long time ago. And she wrote the song because my daddy was a priest. of the Abacua religion. So it was dedicated to my daddy,
okay,
Marco Gonzalez. And then I sing Abacua lyrics for him as well. But it was written by Glicerita. Initially, it was a symphonic song. It was like with three movements, a symphonic piece. And then we adapted the symphonic piece to the band, to the Afro-Cuban jazz music. And she is excellent. She wrote the arrangement, she wrote the song.
But she's your daughter. What do you expect?
Beg your pardon?
She's your daughter. What do you expect?
She is my daughter. She is my daughter. And I love her. I love her. I'm so proud of them. So proud.
Yeah. So here's the deal.
Yes.
This is just chapter one of the Juan Barrington Mimi Speak Freely deal.
All right.
We are deeply grateful, thankful.
Thank you, my brother.
The time.
Muchas gracias.
We honestly believe that if we don't tell our story, nobody will. And if they do, they're not going to tell it the way that we did. And one of the things that has always stuck with me when I talk to you, they always say that success has many fathers and failure has none. And when you created the Buena Vista Club, or social club, all of these people started trying to say that they were the ones who did it. But you are the originator.
And I'm so, a kind of daddy.
Yeah, you're the daddy. You're the godfather.
The godfather, right? Yeah.
So, so for me, my thing is like, use the talents that God gave me to let people know what the truth is. Our truth, our narrative. Because what did they say? They say you'll never learn the story of the hunted, the animal, until the animal learns to write. You'll always hear the story of the hunter.
Absolutely right. It's so. Absolutely. And the story is written by the winners.
Yeah.
We don't know what happened during the Glicerius times at the Roman Empire.
Yeah.
And we will never know what happened with the people from Cartago,
mm-hmm,
because the history was written by Plinio, who was a Roman.
Yeah, yeah.
And he wrote that they made sacrifices of the kids, and we don't know if it is true or not.
Yeah, yeah. So keep doing what you're doing. We love you.
Gracias, mi hermano.
And we're going to do this again soon.
Of course, whenever you want, you have to call me. So take care and fly well.
Yeah.
And use these masks.
Yeah.
In order to take care of yourselves.
Yeah.
Because everything is a little gray right now. But it's going to be blue again.
It's going to be blue. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, Talia. Thank you, Jorge.
Thank you, Nigel.
Thank you, Ada. Thank you, Sean.
Juan, I just want to tell you that Nigel Thompson, my cinematographer from Trinidad, he's working on some movies, and he already said, oh, forget it, we're putting Juan in every movie we do.
Well, there's no problem. If you want music, I can write music for you.
Okay.
Yeah, you know it. That was a conversation we had years ago where you said, you know, hey, I want to do scores, and that's got you and Glicerita and Laurita written all over it.
Yeah, of course. You just have to call me, and that's it. Everything should be done.
All of us gonna make money.
Money's not the most important thing. Meanwhile, you have enough to go to a supermarket and to put fuel in your car. You're okay. And you're healthy. Meanwhile, you're healthy.
Yeah.
This is what's important.
Health. Yeah. We're going to
it is. It is.
Not wealth.
Yeah.
Health.
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 Yeah.
Health is a form of wealth. If we could bottle how we are now, the pandemic gave us time. I grew a whole farm outside.
Yeah, I know. I remember. I was at your house. I was there. I was there. And I remember the farm in the back, in the backyard, where I do smoke my cigars. Well, take a lot of care. Thank you very much for inviting me. Juan. And
give the family our love.
And we'll talk soon.
Okay,
thank you.
Ciao.
You
take care.
I don't know how to get out.
Leave studio.
Ciao, familia.
We'll end the broadcast.
Take care.